whatever preventive strategies.
So we talked about nonverbal strategies, and now we're going to talk about verbal strategies. Some of our verbal strategies are priming. Priming is when we're getting a student ready for a transition. All right, in 1 minute, we're going to go down to the cafeteria. In 2 minutes, we're going to clean up for lunch. Pre-teaching is a skill that we use with a lot of our learners of various levels. Say you have a child that's going into a general education math class. You may pre-teach the lesson before you bring them in so they feel more prepared. Pre-teaching can also be used in social situations, getting a haircut. We use social stories a lot for that. I know a lot of you are familiar with social stories. Pre-teaching can be used for just about anything. I mean, when I came here, I needed to know what the computer setup was like. I wanted to come by and check it out because I wanted to have that knowledge before I was put into a novel situation. So it's not just something that our kids, really respond to, but it's something that typically developing individuals respond to as well. And we've talked a lot about behavior-specific praise. That can be used all the time. I use it with adults. I use it with children. I really like how you're doing this, this, or that. We want to draw attention to what they're doing correctly.
And other students ideally will see that and vicariously follow suit.
So same with any prompts, we want to eventually fade the prompting back. So if I'm teaching a learner to say the phrase, "I like hamburgers," the first down here would be give the entire word or phrase or model the sentence. So I would say, "I like hamburgers," and they would master that. The next one up, say most of the word, but let the child finish. "I like hamburgers." Next one, start with the sound or the beginning of the sentence. It rhymes with, that would be for much higher level learners, it rhymes with whatever the word rhymes with. You use it for, that's a higher level skill. You eat with it, you get it at McDonald's. Connecting it to another event memory. We had this at our school picnic last time. And then wait time, which is when you would just wait for them to respond without any prompts. So once each level is mastered, we can move up to the next level. Again, to fade that prompting to foster autonomy. Verbal prompts, again, we've said this many times throughout today, verbal prompts are more difficult to fade than physical prompts. We want to promote independence, not learned helplessness.
And you'll see that with a lot of students, they will really become prompt dependent on those verbal prompts, and so you can kind of get yourself in a sticky spot trying to fade those.
If you teach skills such as hand washing and you only use verbal prompting, it's going to be very hard to teach that in the absence of verbal prompting. So we want to utilize physical prompting, gestural prompting for skills that we're trying to make independent, which is pretty much all of the skills we teach. We want to eventually be independent. Verbal strategies, we talked about paralanguage, which is your tone of voice, the way you carry yourself. So again, firm, neutral tones when you're delivering a directive. I like to do like a really sing-songy tone, the ABA voice, when I'm delivering behavior-specific praise. Wow, that's really good! When you've been doing this for a while, you develop an ABA voice. It's really high and sing-songy, and it can be a little much at first, but you get used to it. Transition warnings, we all use them, 1 minute until, 5 minutes until, depending on your student. Limits, when you're out in the playground, you can go on this swing, but not on this tire swing over here. And choices, again, choice-making opportunities. Which worksheet would you like to do first? Do you want to bring the attendance down to the office first, or do you want to choose your lunch first?
And there are times where you could pair a verbal strategy with a visual strategy. So like a transition warning, that 3-2-1 countdown board that I passed around before, you could pair that with a verbal of 3 more minutes as you point. So you're having a gesture in there too. So you're really combining strategies.
We did in the beginning, we want to point out what they should do, not necessarily what they shouldn't do. Always use that behavior-specific phrase. Use simple language, again, short, to the point, not a question.
Not too many words.
Yep, not too many words. If you want them to stand up, the direction should just be stand up. Use a neutral, firm voice. Allow time for a response. This is really important. Sometimes people need, more than 2 seconds to process what you're saying and do it. I'm guilty of this too. If you give a direction, wait 10 seconds before you give it again, because sometimes they just need that time to either physically get themselves off the ground, or they need that processing time to realize what you said and then, you know, chain the motor activity to actually complete the task. Give directives, not questions. Again, we talked about that. You want to...
if you give them a chance to say no, they'll say
no. They're going to say no. So just pose directions as statements, not as questions. Very important. Transition warnings. Verbal transition warnings with the transition visual. So if you have a visual schedule, in 1 minute we're going to go to OT. Again, what Tim said with the 3-2-1, visuals and verbals can be paired together. Example, 5 more minutes until recess is done.